Dear all, in my earlier lecture, I solved a couple of problems on rectangular channel and trapezoidal channel with reference to most economical sections and also with reference to the various parameters. We talk about discharge and we discussed about velocity. Let us continue with one more problem. The problem goes like this. A circular sewer, 0.6 meter diameter, has a slope of 1 in 400. Find the depth when the discharge is 0.283 meter cube per second, taking the Chase's constant C as 50. So this is the problem. First, we'll note down what is the data given in the problem. Data given, diameter of the circular pipe. So it is 0.6 meter. Therefore, radius is 0.6 divided by 2, that is 0.3 meters. Slope of the sewer is 1 in 400. Discharge Q is equal to 0.283 meter cube per second. Chase's constant C is equal to 50. First, we'll write the equation for this wetted area for a circular sewer. So, wetted area is given by R square divided by 2 into theta minus sine theta. Then wetted perimeter P is equal to R theta. Now, before start writing the solution, please write the figure. So, with reference to this question, so the figure, please refer to this figure. In this figure, I mentioned the radius as 0.3. And the depth of flow, I represent that as y. And this theta, the angle subtended with reference to the free surface with respect to the center, I represent that as theta. Now, in this case, the first thing, once you write the equation for the wetted area and the wetted perimeter, find the hydraulic mean radius. What is hydraulic mean radius? It is the ratio of wetted area divided by wetted perimeter. Now you know the equation for this wetted area, that is given by R square by 2 into theta minus sine theta, and wetted perimeter P is equal to R theta. Therefore, the equation, if you substitute these two equations in this hydraulic mean radius, so you are going to get this R is equal to R divided by 2 into theta minus sine theta, whole thing divided by theta. So here I skipped one step. So I wrote the final step. Okay. So R is equal to, on simplification, once you substitute the value of A and P in the equation, R is equal to A by P, and on simplification, you are going to get R divided by 2 into theta minus sine theta divided by theta. Now, so 0.R, if you further simplify that, so that becomes R is equal to 0.3 into theta minus sine theta divided by 2 theta. So what I did in this case, in place of R, I substitute the value of 0.3. Okay. So therefore, R is equal to 0.3 into theta minus sine theta whole thing divided by 2 theta. Now, you have the value of A, you have the value of P, and you have the value of R. Now consider the discharge equation. So what is the discharge equation? Q is equal to A into V. Now in this problem, Chase's constant C is given. Therefore, what I'm going to do is, in place of V, I'm going to substitute this Chase's equation. So what is Chase's equation? V is equal to C into root of RS. Now in place of V, I'm going to substitute this C into root of RS. Therefore, the equation you are going to get is Q is equal to AC into root of RS. Now, if you look at this equation, so what is given in the problem? Q is given, that is 0.283 meter cube per second, and the value of Chase's constant C is equal to 50. Substitute the values, you are going to get 0.283 is equal to, so 0.92, okay, how you are going to get 0.92? The value of R is 0.3, okay? So square that, because wetted area is given by R square by 2 into theta minus sine theta. So 0.3 square, you're going to get 0.09 divided by 2 into theta minus sine theta. That is with reference to wetted area multiplied by the Chase's constant phi 0 into, so hydraulic mean radius, you simplified that and the final value of R is 0.3 into theta minus sine theta whole thing divided by 2 theta into, so slope is 1 by 400 that is given in the problem, so into 1 by 400 whole thing under root or whole thing raised to 1 by half. So the only unknown in this equation is theta. So solve for theta by trial and error. So we are going to get theta is equal to 286 degree. Okay. So that is the value of theta. Next one is, so once you get the value of theta, so most of the time we are looking for, so if the radius of the sewer is 0.3 meters or the diameter of the sewer is 0.6 meters, what is the depth of flow of fluid in the sewer pipe? So in order to find the value of this depth of flow, we make use of this formula. Okay, you need to be careful. This I didn't discuss about this formula while talking about the theory. So please remember this formula. Depth of flow is equal to R plus R cos into 180 minus theta by 2. What is theta? The theta which you determined just now. Substitute the values. So y is equal to, so r is 0.3 plus 0.3 cos 180 minus 286 divided by 2. And if you simplify this, you're going to get the depth of flow in the circular sewer as 0.54 meter. Okay. Now, the dia of the sewer is 0.6 meters. And the depth of flow in the sewer works out to be 0.54 meter. So these are the different types of problems you can expect in the examination. Okay, so we'll go further. So the next topic is energy principle in open channel flow. Okay, now kindly recall, at the beginning of this chapter, we discussed about three basic principles of fluid mechanics. One is law of conservation of mass. The second one is law of conservation of energy. The third one is impulse momentum equation. Now, law of conservation of energy states that energy can neither be created nor be destroyed in a system. Now, based on this law of conservation of energy, we derived Euler's equation. From Euler's equation, we derived Bernoulli's equation. Now, based on Bernoulli's equation, so you studied venturi meter, you studied orifice meter and the pitot tube in mechanics of fluids or fluid mechanics in third semester. Now, what is this total energy? Total energy consists of three energies. One is datum energy. This datum energy is also called potential energy. The second one is pressure energy. And the third one is kinetic energy. The total energy at any point in a flowing fluid is given by, okay, Z, the datum energy, plus P by gamma, the pressure energy, plus V square by 2G. So this is what you studied in your third semester. Now, rather than writing this P by gamma, I replace this P by gamma by Y. So how I replace this P by gamma here by Y here? So kindly go back to your third semester fluid mechanics second chapter, fluid pressure and its measurement. So we derived an equation for the intensity of pressure at any point. So the intensity of pressure at any point is given by gamma into H. So what is gamma? The specific weight of the fluid. What is head? Head H. H is called the pressure head. Now P is equal to gamma into H. Now I want the value of H. So H is equal to P divided by gamma. So kindly recall how we differentiated between the open flow and the pipe flow. So I said, in case of a open channel flow, the free surface of water, at the free surface of water, the pressure is atmospheric. That is, at the free surface, P is equal to P atmospheric.
Okay, so therefore, the depth of water or depth of fluid flowing over the bed surface that is given by the pressure head that is given by Y. So in this case, my P by gamma can be written as the depth of flow, that is Y. Please refer to this figure. In this figure, so the pink line, what I presented here, is the datum line. What is a datum line? It is an arbitrary line with respect to which you are going to measure the pressure. Now, pink line is a datum line with respect to which I am going to measure the total energy. Now, you have the datum energy or the potential energy plus the pressure energy. Pressure energy in this case is given by Y, and above that, you have this kinetic energy, that is V square by 2G. And if you combine these three energies, kinetic energy, pressure energy, plus the datum energy, you are going to get the total energy at any given point of point in a flowing fluid. Okay. Now, Bernoulli's equation states that the total energy all along the ridge remains the same. Okay. With reference to that, so we discussed about the total energy with respect to an ideal fluid and with respect to a real fluid. So in case of an ideal fluid, since there are no losses, the total energy at suction 1 and the total energy at suction 2 remains the same. But if you talk about a real fluid, from suction 1 to suction 2, there is a pressure drop due to the pipe roughness. So whatever the total energy you are measuring at suction 1 will not be equal to the total energy you're going to measure at suction 2. In that case, if at all if you want to apply this Bernoulli's equation, then the total energy at suction 1 is equal to the total energy at suction 2. The total energy at suction 2 becomes, so Z plus P2 by gamma plus V2 square by 2G plus HL, the head loss that is happening between suction 1 and suction 2. That is what we are going to do in case of a real fluid. And that's how you people, you solve problems on this venturi meter and also orifice meter. With that basics, let us proceed further. Now, just now I said, if we measure this total energy with respect to an arbitrary datum, okay, the total energy comprises of datum energy, pressure energy, and kinetic energy. Now, rather than measuring this energy with respect to an arbitrary datum, if I measure the energy with respect to the channel bottom itself as reference, then in that case, the energy is given by, so that is given by capital E. E is equal to, right now, I am measuring the energy with respect to the channel bottom. So above that, you have the pressure energy, P by gamma, plus the kinetic energy, V square by 2G. Now, when you're measuring the energy with respect to channel bottom, datum energy or the potential energy will not be there. So therefore, E is equal to, I'm going to replace this P by gamma by Y. Therefore, you're going to get E is equal to Y plus V square by 2G. Now, if you measure the energy with respect to the channel bottom, then the energy is called the specific energy. If you measure the energy with respect to an arbitrary datum, the energy you are going to get is known as total energy. Rather than measuring the energy with respect to an arbitrary datum, if you measure the energy with respect to channel bottom, the energy you are going to get is known as specific energy. This is the difference between specific energy and total energy. Let us see how to define this specific energy. Specific energy of a flowing fluid in a channel is defined as energy per unit weight of the liquid measured from the channel bottom or channel bed as datum. This is very, very important. Please underline this, channel bed as datum. Now, whatever I discussed now, that I presented in this figure, okay? Now, this is a open channel. Now consider two sections, section 1 and section 2. Now, this is the arbitrary line with respect to which you are going to measure the pressure, I mean energy. The total energy at section 1 is given by Z1 plus Y1 plus V1 square by 2G into alpha 1. Alpha 1 is called a kinetic energy correction factor. For your case, we consider this energy correction factor as 1. So that's why, so most of the time, we take this energy correction factor alpha is equal to 1, you are going to get Z1 plus Y1 plus V1 square by 2G. But when you come to section 2, the total energy at section 2 is given by Z2 plus Y2 plus V2 square by 2G plus HL. This is what I said just now. Now, specific energy is given by potential energy. It is not potential energy. There is a typo here. It is the pressure energy. Pressure energy of flow at section 1. So that is given by Y1 and here it is Y2. Or in general, this pressure energy is given by Y and the kinetic energy of flow is given by V square by 2G. Again, I repeat, kindly correct it. This is the pressure energy of flow at different sections. Okay. Therefore, this specific energy is given by E of P plus E of K. Now, next step, what I'm going to do is, if you take out previous question papers, most of the time in the examination, they will ask you to write the specific energy diagram. What is this specific energy diagram and how to write this specific energy diagram? Okay, now you have the equation for this specific energy. What is that specific equation? So E is equal to Y plus V square divided by 2G. I repeat, E is equal to Y plus V square divided by 2G. Now, Q is equal to A into V. So from that equation, so I want the value of V. V is equal to Q divided by A. Now in the general equation, E is equal to Y plus V square divided by 2G. I replace this V by Q by A. You are going to get the equation E is equal to Y plus Q square divided by 2G A square. This is another form for this specific energy. Now, what is this specific energy diagram? The specific energy diagram or specific energy curve can be plotted graphically as a function of depth of flow. So in other words, so if you look at the right hand side of this equation, so E is equal to Y plus V square by 2G. I said, so you had a pressure energy plus you had a kinetic energy. Now, if you plot this specific energy with reference to this potential energy or with reference to the depth, okay, so if you consider only this pressure energy, you are going to get an equation somewhat like this, a straight line, a 45 degree line. I repeat, a graph of depth versus the specific energy, considering only the pressure energy, we are going to get a 45 degree line originating from the origin. That is what you are seeing here. That I represented as ES. Now in the next graph, if I plot this depth of flow versus the specific energy, and if I consider only the kinetic energy, then you are going to get a graph like this. This is E of K. So this is the kinetic energy. This is the pressure energy. Now, if you plot this kinetic energy and the pressure energy, okay, against this depth of flow and this specific energy, you are going to get specific energy curve. That is what you are going to see here. So in this case, as I mentioned earlier, this 45 degree line represents the graph of depth of flow versus the specific energy considering only the pressure energy. That is why. Now, if you plot this depth of flow versus the specific energy, considering both the pressure energy as well as the kinetic energy, you are going to get a curve like this, the blue curve, what right now you are seeing here. Now, this curve is called the kinetic energy curve. Now, if you look at this curve, it has two limbs. For example, if we talk about, if we give a notation, I call this as point C, this is point A, and this is point B. This specific energy curve consists of two limbs. This is AC and BC. What is this AC and what is this BC and what is this point? This we'll discuss in the next slide. Now, with reference to this, okay, I mentioned this. So, E minimum. So, what is this E minimum? And if you consider a point, so next to this E minimum, you have two depths. So, these two depths are called alternate depths. So, that is given by Y1 and Y2. All these details we'll see in the next slide. Now, let us go one step further. Let us talk about the specific energy curve for a rectangular channel. Okay, now consider a rectangular channel having a constant discharge. My capital Q is constant. Then what is this small q? Small q is discharge per unit width. Okay. Now, discharge per unit width, that is given by capital Q divided by B. Right now, I am talking about the rectangular channel. So, you had a value of Q, you had a value of B. Now, what is the specific energy equation? So, Y plus V square by 2G. Replace this V by Q by A. Therefore, the equation takes up the form E is equal to Y plus Q square divided by 2G A square. Now, in place of Q, I'm going to substitute this Q in place of Q by B, I'm going to substitute this Q. So there is no B term in there. Whereas you have this Q square divided by 2G A square. Since it's a rectangular channel, the weighted area is given by B into H. So, in place of A, if you substitute this B into H and if you solve, you are going to get the equation for the specific energy as E is equal to H plus small q square divided by 2G H square. Don't get confused. In the earlier slide, I represent this depth as Y. So, with reference to this figure, I am representing the depth as H. Now, E is equal to H plus Q square divided by 2G H square. What is H? H is the depth of flow in the channel. So E is equal to H plus Q square divided by 2G H square. Now I want all of you to concentrate on this figure. As I said earlier, so depth versus specific energy, you are going to get a specific energy curve. So I said, if you plot this depth versus specific energy, considering only this value of H, you are going to get this 45 degree line. That is what I presented here, E of P is equal to H. Now, if you plot this depth versus E, considering only this kinetic energy, that is small q square divided by 2G H square, you are going to get this curve. That is what I presented here, E of K is equal to Q square divided by 2G H square. Now I want a graph, summing of these two graphs. So you are going to get the specific energy curve. If you plot this, if you add, cumulate this and this, you are going to get this curve, that is ACB. And this curve is called the specific energy curve. Now, please concentrate on this figure or specific energy curve. So, as I mentioned earlier, it consists of two limbs, a rising limb and a descending limb. Now, AC and BC. What is this AC? What is this BC?
And what is this critical flow, supercritical flow, and subcritical flow that we'll see in the next slide. Now, the depth of flow at point C is referred to as critical depth. The depth of flow at point C is referred to as critical depth. We'll go back to the figure. Now, this is the point C, and on y-axis, we plotted this y. On x-axis, we are plotting this value of E. Now, corresponding to this point C, if you draw a horizontal line, this horizontal line will cut the vertical axis at this point. From the origin, if you measure this distance, so this depth is your critical depth. That is given by HC. That is what I mentioned in the first point. So the depth of flow at point C is referred to as critical depth YC. It is defined as the depth of flow of a liquid at which the specific energy is minimum. Okay, now look at this. This is the minimum specific energy. This is the minimum specific energy. So, corresponding to this minimum specific energy, the depth is called the critical depth. The flow that corresponds to this point is critical flow. When the depth of flow in the channel is critical depth, the flow is called the critical flow. Now, at this point, go back to the earlier class where we discussed about the different types of flows in open channels. Kindly recall, I said, depending on the Proud's number, we have critical flow, subcritical flow, supercritical flow. I said, for critical flow, Proud's number is equal to 1. For supercritical flow, Proud's number is greater than 1. For subcritical flow, Proud's number is less than 1. Now, so if the flow is critical flow, for which the depth is critical depth, specific energy is minimum, then the flow is critical flow, for which the Proud's number is equal to 1. This is the first point. Now, look at the second point. For values of E greater than E minimum, there are two corresponding depths. Look at this. Now I am moving away from this point C. I consider this point H. Now from this point H, if you drop a perpendicular, okay, this perpendicular will cut the specific energy curve at this point G. Okay, so for this specific energy, which I call it as E, there are two depths. So one is called H1, the other one is called H2. So for any other specific energy, apart from this E minimum, I have two depths, Y1 and Y2 or H1 or H2. These depths, H1 and H2, are called the alternate depths. H1 and H2 are called the alternate depths. That is what I mentioned here. There are two corresponding depths. One depth is greater than the critical depth. The other is smaller than the critical depth. These two depths for a given specific energy are called the alternate depths. For example, if the depth of flow is greater than YC, E increases as Y increases. Let us go back to the figure. Now, right now, I am talking about this with reference to this point H. Now, this H, so here, this is the critical depth. Now, you are moving upwards. Your H2 is greater than H1. Okay? And this is the E minimum. You are moving away from this E minimum. Therefore, E increases. So, as depth increases, E increases with reference to this point H. Now, corresponding to this, the flow is supercritical flow. This is the first case. Now come to the second case. So corresponding to this point G, where the depth is less than the critical depth. Depth is H1 corresponding to this G, and it is less than the critical depth. Whereas E is more than E minimum. And corresponding to this situation,
The flow is called subcritical flow. So you have supercritical flow and subcritical flow. Okay. Now, if the depth of flow y is less than yc, e decreases as y increases. So the flow is said to be supercritical, for which Proud's number greater than 1, and if for subcritical, it is Proud's number less than 1. Okay. The same thing I presented again in another figure. Now look at this figure. This is the normal cross-section of the channel. So here I showed three depths. One is a critical depth. The other one is y1. The other one is y2. Now corresponding to this y1 and y2, these two depths are called alternate depths. And this is the critical depth. Now corresponding to this depth, the flow is subcritical, and here it is supercritical. Okay. Now that is about the specific energy curve. Now we'll go to the next one, critical depth in a rectangular channel. Just now I mentioned about this critical depth. So if the specific energy is minimum, the depth corresponding to the specific energy minimum is called the critical depth. So this I'll do it in my next lecture.